Rewriting one logic into another in order to perform inferencing on the result is one of the most prominent techniques in knowledge representation and reasoning. And in this talk, I'm going to present to you some more details about our 2020 paper on rewriting the description logic Alchic to disjunctive existential rules. I have already spoken about this in a short video, which provides you with the motivation and context, and I will now continue to give you a few more details. This is joint work with David Karal. My name is Markus Krötsch, and I am at TU Dresden. Welcome back. Now, I already have given to you this definition that explains that a rewriting in our sense here is a fact entailment preserving rewriting, where we obtain one theory, T2, that in the context of an arbitrary set of ground facts F will give us the exact same ground fact entailments as the original theory T1. Now, this is a useful thing to have, and it is particularly interesting in description logic, where we often separate the terminological knowledge, the T box, from the actual facts, the A box, and the latter is typically much larger than the former. Now, I have explained to you in my last video what kind of languages we consider. We have several variants of rule languages based on data log, with disjunctions, with existentials, or with both. And we will in particular look at the description logic Alchic, which can be normalized into these 9 forms of rules that require equality here to express the number restrictions, and disjunctions to express the non-determinism of ALC, and also feature inverses, as you can see in this last rule here. Now, if you have Horn ALC, HIQ, you simply omit the disjunctions here in those rules, and the rest is as before. Okay, so these are the logics we are dealing with. And what I had then shown you was this table with prior work and many different types of translations. And I have argued that in spite of the many works that have been done in the area, many have certain shortcomings in terms of the size of the rewriting, which is not a theoretical issue, but can turn into a practical issue, because tools do not like to have very large rule sets to handle, and they also do not like to have very large rules to consider. And we will see in a minute what I mean with large rule and how this comes about. I explained to you then that only a few approaches have so far managed to obtain polynomial rewritings that are bounded in the types of rules, and that this is also due to some inherent complexity theoretic limitations, because these description logics often have high complexities, but when you bound the rules, the complexity of the rule language is getting much lower, and then you cannot achieve a polynomial transformation anymore on principled grounds, or at least under common complexity theoretic assumptions. We have recently found ways around this, especially using existential quantifiers, because there it turns out that with the help of existentials, you can indeed have a very high computational power even in a polynomial bounded rule theory. Of course, that's maybe not surprising, because as soon as you add existentials, technically reasoning becomes undecidable. So whenever we use such a language here with existentials, we have to argue also how the result can actually be used in reasoning and why it still works. And it will work in all cases that we consider. So for these transformations we have, we also know that there are effective sound and complete reasoning techniques available. Now, the new results I already advertised in my last short talk are the 3 that you see here, mainly in one case for the general case of Alchic, and in the other for the deterministic Horn version of it. And we get the results that for the general case we need disjunction, and we can make do with data log with disjunctions if we accept unbounded rules using similar ideas as have been used in these papers by Magdalena Ortiz and collaborators. We can also get rid of this effect of unboundedness by using existentials. And this is quite a different technique from the ones that we have used here. In fact, the technique that was used in this previous paper is much more similar to what we would use in the third case, and I will not go into the details of this here in this very short talk, because I think this is maybe the more interesting cases. Now, in all three cases, we are using different principles for reasoning and different approaches. So let me just give you maybe an overview, a bit of a sketch on the first two, so that you have an idea of how we approach this and how this works. So the first thing we would like to look at is the transformation from Alchic into disjunctive data log. And the underlying idea here is that we use a type-based calculus. Now, types have been used in description logic reasoning in several works before, and in general in all the various kinds of logical reasoning, of course, before. The idea there is that a type is some kind of local structure that you may find in the model of a certain logical theory. How exactly the structure looks depends on works that you are considering. In our case, the types that we are interested in are structures of this shape here. You can see here in the sketch, there are two elements I call here C and D. They are somehow connected by some relationships. And the element D is further connected to L, other elements S1 to SL, via some other relationships. And each of these elements are in certain description logic classes that I denote here with this vector representation C and D and E1 to EL. Now, the type here is really mainly about the pair C and D. The S1 to SL are actually just to provide necessary successors that the logic requires to exist. Because for every rule of the form A of X implies exists Y, R of X, Y, B of Y, or which would be an existential axiom in the description logic as well, we will have one such successor. So if you have a fixed ontology given, you have a fixed number of rules of this form, and you just look at types where for every such rule, you have already one representative that describes how this rule would be satisfied, which thing exists according to this rule that would be in the model. This is the idea. Okay, you can see that all of these parts of the types are described by sets of concepts and sets of relations, of roles or of inverse roles. And of course, this is a finite and constant number of such sets, and each of the sets is finite and bounded by a constant, because there's only a finite number of concepts and relations that we have to consider. So overall, we can represent such a type finitely by just storing these finite sets and by essentially encoding in some way what is in the sets and what is not. And to do this, we use a technique that has been proposed before by Magdalena Ortiz and Sebastian Rudolph and Manta Shimkus, I think, for the first time, which consists in representing such sets as bit vectors. So the idea is that we just take some order of the potential elements of all of these sets, and then we just store as a bit vector of zeros and ones that encodes the presence or absence of an element of in any of these sets. And once we have settled on this encoding, we can have facts of this form type of some bit vector to describe one such type. And so this can be done in a finite, bounded, fixed arity fashion. And now you can see what the potential problem, of course, is with such a representation. It will give us predicates which have thousands of parameters. And this is something that may not work well in practice in current systems, certainly. But at least it solves the problem on a theoretical level. Now, why do we want to represent these types? Of course, the idea with any type-based calculus is that the satisfiability of a logical theory is equivalent to the existence of a suitable, complete, and consistent set of types. So I state this here in this little box without much explanations. An ALCHIQ ontology is satisfiable if and only if it admits a consistent set of types. What does consistent mean? Well, first of all, the types, each of the types themselves have to satisfy the requirements stated in the ontology. So all the axioms of the ontology, as far as they apply to this small structure, have to be true. And also, there have to be enough types, and necessary types have to exist. For example, for every part of the A box, for every fact that we are given, there must be a suitable type in our model that describes the relationships that are in the A box. Okay. Now, I'm not going to give you the detailed conditions, but the key idea here is now that we could use rules data lock with disjunctions in this case to describe exactly what a consistent set of types has to look like, what it has to satisfy, and if this data lock program then has a solution, has certain entailments, these will be exactly the entailments that we also would get from the ontology. So this is the whole idea. Take this type approach and then encode all the conditions in rules. Okay. But this, as I said, will lead to very large predicates. Now, we would like to avoid this. And to do this, we use a very different technique based on disjunctive existential rules, where we want to mimic a tableau calculus in rules. How does a tableau work? Well, we start with some kind of A box, some facts that are given to us, and then we will construct more information about them. In our case, we first add some shadow predicates to the A box. For every A, we introduce a blackboard font A, and for every S, a blackboard font S. These are like duplicates of the whole vocabulary, and we will use these duplicates for most of the tableau. Only the A box itself will use the originals, because these will be our entailments that we want to have. So this is simply copying operation for now. And then the tableau works as usual. We conclude new information based on the ontology and the structure that is given. And in some cases, it will be necessary to expand the tableau. So sometimes some new node has to be introduced in the tableau. And this mainly occurs if we have axioms like this one here, where it says every A has an R successor that is a B, which in our case translates into such a rule here. And this rule, as you can see, has an existential quantifier. And this existential quantifier, to be satisfied, requires the existence of such a new element. So we directly mimic the tableau mechanics in rules. We also have this additional predicate suck here, which is the successor relation to keep the structure of the tableau in our model. Now, after creating a successor, we will also complete it in a certain way by essentially guessing the value of all possible classes and relations along this new part of the structure. We do this using disjunctions, gently saying if something is a successor, then it has to be either in S or in S not. S not is another new name we introduce for this. And we blindly guess this at this point. We will validate it then and make sure that the guess is not inconsistent in any place. So in this way, we get a complete representation where we know about the presence, but also about the absence of any kind of symbol here. And in this way, the tableau can continue. We can create new successors as usual by applying rules and introduce new nodes. And the challenge with this, of course, like in any tableau, is that we would like this to stop at some point. We would like to terminate. And in tableaus, usually this is done by blocking. The technique we adopt here is also a blocking-like technique, which is somewhat similar to pairwise anywhere blocking, as it has been called for Tableau, meaning that we compare elements by not just comparing a single element like N3 and N4, but also their predecessors and the relationships between the element and the predecessor. And we can see with N3 and N4 that they have the same concepts, the same relationships from their predecessors, and the same concepts in the predecessors, so we will conclude that they are of the same type, for which we have the same tip predicate here in our paper. Okay, and once they are of the same type, essentially we could say one blocks the other. So if one has already been expanded, we will not expand the other. Now, unfortunately, this cannot be expressed in rules because it's non-monotonic. We need to say this in a different fashion. We cannot say if it's not blocked, then it has a successor. That would contradict monotonicity. So what we do instead is we derive that all the successors of one of the nodes are also successors of the other. So we copy successors from one to the other. And this effectively means that N4 now already has a successor without a new element being introduced. And when we apply an existential rule at this stage, it will be detected that there already is a suitable element to satisfy the existential rule, and we will not apply a new existential rule or create a new element here. So in this sense, the what we do here is what is called the restricted chase. So summing up, there are two important techniques here to ensure termination. One is to use the restricted chase, where we check before we create something. The other one is to prioritize non-generating, non-existential rules, so that we really know that things are of the same type and we know that they have a same successor before we even start constructing any new element. So this is the gist of this second approach. Now, summing up, what we have seen is that there are two rewritings here, from Alchic to data log with disjunctions and existential rules with disjunctions. There's also a version for Horn Alchic, which I didn't show here. The existential rules give us polynomial sized bounded rule rewritings, and they are still terminating in exponential time, or in non-deterministic exponential time if you have disjunctions. Open challenges. There are a few. One is certainly how we can make this worst case optimal, because it turns out that data log with disjunctions always gives us a non-deterministic exponential time complexity, whereas Alchic itself is only x time complete without non-determinism. And so far, no approach has managed to match this optimal worst case complexity, and we might need a better way to do the chase in the disjunctive case to get down to x time from the general setting. Of course, there can also be more rewritings. There's still more DLs where there's no rewriting, and implementations would definitely be an interesting endeavor to continue this work. So that's all for this short talk. You can find all the materials online, and if you have any question, do not hesitate to get in touch with us. Thank you for watching. Bye-bye.